Well, hello there, and welcome to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightsight. We are the retro talk program for nostalgia and baby boomer stuff right here on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And we welcome you to our show today. We're pleased to have you with us. It's a nice Saturday early afternoon, and we just got through having our monthly breakfast and meeting at our favorite retro diner. And Mike and I are here fortified with energy, and our tummies are full, and so we're going to do this show for you, and we're glad to have you with us. And this brought up the topic that we were talking about, just thinking back to the earlier times when we were little, and then when we were a little bit older, about what it was like to go out and have dinner with the family, or later on when we were able to sort of get out on our own and drive around and have a little bit of extra money. But let's start at the beginning. Mike, I think you and I probably have a sort of a common thread in that our families really didn't go out to eat dinner at a restaurant when we were little. That was like some sort of a special occasion, and it was not a common thing, probably not as nowhere near as common as what it is now.
Yes, true, Smitty. I think that's a common thread with most middle-class, middle-income American families in the 1950s and 1960s, and for that matter, the first part of the 1970s decade. There, what we kind of take for granted nowadays are these retro diners,
right?
That basically a restaurant that somebody went out and bought a whole bunch of retro 50s kitsch and goodies, things that, memorable goodies, statues of Elvis and lunchboxes and whatnot, kind of like the Antique Row Cafe that you mentioned earlier. But those were very real, very original back in the mid-20th century. And I remember these were truly diners that were established in the 30s and 1940s. In L.A., there were quite a number of them. A lot of the buildings still stand. And as time goes by, a lot of these, a lot of the trends in dining have changed one way or the other. But memorable are the diners. And when we say diners, we mean the, well, in some cases, you'd call them the greasy spoon.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Or the local family diner. Or the, they would have cool names like the charcoal broiler. But we didn't go out all that much either. We were, again, middle class, Los Angeles urban middle class families. My mom did the cooking because my mom didn't work, and she did work, but her job was keeping us. And about 4 o'clock every afternoon, my brothers and I would be home doing our homework, and we'd start hearing those pans rustling over in the kitchen and some great aromas coming from the kitchen.
Sure.
And that would mean a couple hours later that dinner would be ready. And I would say probably 90% of the time as far as dinner would be home cooked by my mom. But there were times where we would venture out. It might be a family night somewhere or maybe doing some errands, and we'd end up at one of the local restaurants. There were no big chain restaurants that I can recall at the time, other than one famously known as Bob's Big Boy.
Yes.
And we could talk about that. We could do a show of its own on Bob's Big Boy, but that was a very special place for us to go. Of course, the little chubby guy with the checkered coveralls and holding the platter, also known as the Bob's Big Boy combination.
Yeah.
I probably have consumed easily 500 of those in my lifetime. But those were memorable because, Smitty, they were so special, as you say. They were unique just by the fact that going out was so unique, going out to eat.
It was, Mike, because we never, almost never went out to have dinner when I was a kid. Dinner was always at home, and my mom, like your mom, was a stay-at-home mom, and she would prepare the dinner. She'd prepare the meal. 5 o'clock was usually dinner time when my dad would come home from work, and it was a very sort of a very ritualistic thing to always have dinner. I think that, and you and I had talked about this previously before we went on the air, I think it was the mentality of the time that, you know, you stayed home for dinner. It was the common, if I can word it that way, the common working man's family would be at home having dinner. You wouldn't really consider going out to go eat somewhere. But I do recall one instance when we went out to have dinner, and I know specifically what the date is, and there's a correlation here that I'll get to in just a moment. It was Halloween of 1975, and for some reason, my mom and dad decided they weren't going to hand out candy that year. So my dad announced, we're going to go out and have dinner. And we went to have dinner at a Mexican restaurant in Old Town here in San Diego, in the old historic part of the city. And we went and had dinner. Now, the interesting thing here, why I remember it so vividly, one of the reasons was because it didn't happen all that often. We came home that night, and for some reason, my mom and dad went to the dining room table, and they were talking. I think they were having coffee or something. That allowed me access to the living room TV set, our big 25-inch TV, and I watched the premiere of a movie that I've talked about before, The Night That Panicked America, about the War of the Worlds invasion, the radio broadcast, which we've highlighted before on our War of the Worlds show, and we've talked about it from time to time. That was a very unique experience because we hardly ever went to have dinner. We never, to my recollection, I don't recall, we might have, but I don't remember. That one stands out. But I think more frequently what would happen is on occasion, Dad would announce, we're going to go get hamburgers. We're going to go either to McDonald's or Jack in the Box or your other favorite. That was a huge event. That was like the sky opening, Mike. We were going to have hamburgers for dinner.
Well, Smitty, that's you bring up something two things very dear to me. Both at Jack in the Box and McDonald's, because I grew up in a time where there were very few of either. In Los Angeles, in the area of Los Angeles I grew up in, the McDonald's, as I recall, the McDonald's we knew was probably close to 45 minutes away on the other side of town.
Yeah.
And very seldom would we go over there. But in 1967, a McDonald's was built on York Boulevard in my hometown of Highland Park. And that was something, McDonald's. And my goodness, do I ever, I will never in my life forget the first time I bit into a Big Mac. Now, they were not the Big Macs of today, which probably more honestly would be called Little Macs.
Yeah.
These were a very nice big sandwich, double patties, very fresh. And it was memorable because of the taste was unlike any other hamburger. And I'm a hamburger guy. I grew up on hamburgers. But it was unlike anything I've ever tasted. I believe they were 65 cents. They did not come in a little plastic sarcophagus. They had a little cardboard border surrounding them so they wouldn't collapse, and they were wrapped in tin foil. And that was a delight. A McDonald's Big Mac and a vanilla shake and an order of fries, I think, probably would cost $1.25 each at the time. This was in 1967.
Yeah.
But I do remember McDonald's. No drive-thru. You had to go stand in line, and such as the case of my family, maybe on a Friday night, and my dad wanted to give my mom the night off from cooking, so we'd run down to McDonald's and bring back a big bag of burgers. We seldom would eat out somewhere. Now, my experiences as far as dining, you know, my grandparents were from the South, so you had dinner, but you also had supper.
Mm-hmm.
Dinner was right after church on Sundays. Mm-hmm. And there were a number of restaurants that my grandparents would take me and my brothers to. One was Henry's, right spot, home of Chicken in the Rough. Never forget that. Chicken in the Rough.
What was Chicken in the Rough, Mike?
Chicken in the Rough was disjointed chicken, fried, deep fried, of course, with a big cup of coleslaw on the side and a mountain of French fries and a couple of dinner buns with real butter and a big honey bear jar of honey.
Wow.
And with a plastic bowl nearby with warm water and lemon in it to wash your fingers off, because it was the original finger licking.
There you go,
Greasy finger licking.
Yeah.
But that was our dining experience right after church, and that was a thing. We would be dressed up after it would be after church, and we would go to dinner. Mm-hmm. And that was such a treat, but my folks, we didn't go to dinner a whole lot, other than we would go and get dinner and pick it up and bring it home.
Mm-hmm.
And to bring another, some of you on the West Coast, or I don't know, maybe they were nationwide, I'm not sure, but Chicken Delight, probably in the mid-60s, well, definitely in 64, 65, they came up with a this fast food delivery service called Chicken Delight. Talk about greasy delight. They were prepared. It was fried chicken with crinkle-cut fries, and you'd get a blueberry muffin in a little container of ketchup, and they would deliver it to your door, which was unheard of in L.A. in the mid-60s. And I'll never forget the cars. They were little Rambler ambassadors, and they would have the Chicken Delight logo on the side, but on the top of the cars, they'd have this very large chicken, a big chicken that didn't make it to the deep fryer.
Okay.
And when Chicken Delight came up to your door, you felt like you were special.
Oh, yeah, I'll bet. Yeah, that would have been a unique thing back at that time period. No, you're right, Mike. And again, I think that probably the prevailing thought at that time was that, and maybe it was sort of a, I think we were talking about this a little bit earlier, sort of a depression era type thought that, you know, you had dinner at home, you had food at home. Why were you going to go out to a restaurant to eat? And then I know that now in more recent times, that mentality sort of changed. It's nice to be able to have access to different meals and things. And sometimes maybe we don't have time to cook. People have two jobs and they're running around and taking care of business. So it's easier just to go get something to eat somewhere. And it really wasn't that way, I think, before, because, again, like we said, both of our moms were both stay-home moms.
Yes.
And I don't think today that's not really all that prevalent. Moms work also today outside the home. And I think maybe now the society has changed quite a bit, wouldn't you?
Well, absolutely, Smitty. And as we've talked so many times in the past 11, 12 years of doing these shows, things come full circle. And the drive-in restaurant, back to Bob's Big Boy, we had one in Eagle Rock, but we had another one. The first one was in Glendale, and it had drive-in service with car hops. And they'd come out, these very attractive car hops would come out and take your order, and they'd put a big cardboard number on your windshield, and they would bring the food over in trays. It was like something you'd see in American Graffiti.
Yeah.
But that was a bigger treat than going out to a restaurant was getting a car hop service at Bob's Big Boy. There was another restaurant familiar to those of you out there that are also from L.A. called Vandy Camps. And Vandy Camps had a bakery, and they had a car hop service, drive-in service. But the Vandy Camps, much like we talk in the Depression World War II, there were themes of these restaurants. Vandy Camps, it was the Holland Dutch motif. They had these huge windmills, and that was their trademark. That was their landmark in Los Angeles, was a huge blue windmill that would tell you that's going to be a Vandy Camps there. But the car hop service and having your food taken in a tray and bolted down in the window, or in the driver's case, my dad would be, they'd have a bolt down on the steering wheel. And enjoying your dinner there and watching the activity, especially on a Friday night, was something that, you know, a kid growing up in the 60s would never forget.
Yeah, and I'm sure there was a lot to see. The car hops, were they on roller skates, Mike, or were they walking around?
Not then and there, but there was a drive-in over on Vermont in Hollywood, and they were on roller skates, and that was the inspiration for the drive-in restaurant in the movie American Graffiti. They actually were on roller skates. But we talk about full circle, Smitty, and you know, here in San Diego anyway, there's a number of Sonic drive-ins now.
Yes.
Same idea.
Same idea, exactly right. Yeah, you just drive in, and there's a little speaker-type thing there that you talk into, and the menu's there, you order what you want, and they bring it out. I also seem to remember when I was a kid, I seem to remember us going to A&W. Which was also sort of a car hop-type thing where they would bring you your whatever it was, your A&W root beer with ice cream, or your, you know, your float or whatever it was, and a hamburger perhaps, or something. That was also another place along with Bob's and all these other places.
Well, we're gonna go to a retro commercial, Smitty, and when we come back, we're gonna talk about some of the more interesting places that we would eat as we got older: the Greasy Spoons, the malt shops, the sandwich shops, and more. But let's go to a retro commercial. You are joining us and being a willing participant of the dining experience here on Galaxy Moonbeam Night Sight on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
Mm-hmm. Dinnertime. We've got the beer, Miller beer.
Miller beer. Well, we're talking about food, so I guess beer counts as food, doesn't it, Mike?
I guess so. If you've got the time, we got the beer nowadays.
That's right.
If you don't mind doing some time, you better not be drinking beer and going to a drive-in.
That's right. Not anymore. Not in these days. Welcome back to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside here on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. Gilbert Smitty-Smith along with my buddy Mike Bragg. We're talking about earlier food memories when we were kids, the odd occasion that perhaps we might go out and have dinner. But as we got older and we were able to drive and perhaps had a little job, had a little bit of pocket change in our pockets, we were able to sort of enjoy some of the fast food places, some of the restaurants and things a little bit more frequently, certainly much more than we could have when we were little. You know, Mike, I remember when I was first driving and was able to get together with my friends and we'd go out maybe at night and go do something or whatever. And always invariably, it always involved going out to get something to eat. Part of the evening was going out to get something to eat. So we'd say, well, let's go get a hamburger, or let's go get a sandwich, or let's go get a pizza or something. And that was something that was not certainly something that we didn't do earlier. But when we got to a little bit older, that got to be sort of a special thing that we would do. And now we had access to the fast food places. We had access to restaurants. We had a little bit of money in our pockets. So now we were able to partake much more than we did when we were little with our moms and dads.
Yeah, so true on that one, because you mentioned we were talking about pizzas mm-hmm. at the time. Now, in the early 60s, I can tell you there was not a pizza place. There was not a Domino's or a Pizza Hut or a Pizza Shack or a pizza anything that I can remember in the Los Angeles area I lived in. But however, there's an interesting concept by Chef Boyardee called pizza in a box or pizza in a can or whatnot. Now, I've experienced those. What this was a Chef Boyardee product, and you had the flour or whatever, the dough, and my mom would put the dough together and spread it out on a pizza pan. And you'd get a small container of the tomato sauce or the pizza sauce,
right.
And that would go over the dough, and then you would have to have some type of cheese. My mom would get a roll or a block of mozzarella cheese and cut up slices and put on. That was our cheese and tomato. That was pizza as we knew it.
Wow.
In the early 1960s. That was pizza.
Wow.
But then along came the pizza. I think Shakey's may have been one of among the first over in LA anyway, Shakey's Pizza Parlor.
Mm-hmm.
And then along came the other ones, but it was very seldom that you would have pizza because there were not a lot of pizza places available. Now, you could go to an Italian restaurant. We had a little place in Eagle Rock called Casa Bianca, which everybody would go to if they were going to go out for Italian food. It was a typical mom and pop, family-owned, closely owned, very dark, with the empty Chianti bottles mm-hmm. all over the ceiling. Very authentic, just like something right out of Godfather, which I say, there were not the chains of restaurants, the Chili's and the Applebee's. There were family-owned restaurants and diners, and they were neighborhood, and they knew the people in the neighborhood, and the neighborhood people, there was a lot of customer loyalty at that time.
So I guess maybe not until later did the concept of a pizza restaurant come into being. I mean, like, as you mentioned, prior to that, you'd go to an Italian restaurant if you wanted a genuine pizza.
Yeah, you would.
So during that period of time, then you either made it at home like your mom did, or you'd go to a restaurant. There was no Pizza Hut. There was no Shakey's. There was no Domino's. There was nothing like that.
No, maybe on the East Coast, or of mm-hmm. course, New York, Chicago, forever,
right.
have had the pizza places. But in Los Angeles, you just didn't have a vast selection mm-hmm. of pizza. places that specialize in pizza delivery, fast food, mm-hmm. pizza by the slice, whatnot. They just, the Long Beach Pike or some of the attractions, Santa Monica Pier, they would have a pizza and they would sell pizza by the slice. But that was to teenagers and kids who were going to the beach for the day. But as far as family dining, now you would go to the neighborhood Italian restaurant to get your pizza and for that manner, spaghetti.
Right.
Lasagna.
Right. Probably sandwiches too, you know, torpedo sandwiches.
Absolutely.
And all that,
yeah. Same thing with Mexican food.
Right.
There was no pollo loco. There were no chilies or whatever. Mm-hmm. You went to the neighborhood family Mexican restaurant,
mm-hmm.
and you would sit there in the wooden tables with the colorful tablecloths, and you would sit there, and it was almost a neighborhood, a neighboring ritual.
Mm-hmm.
You'd always see somebody you knew.
Right.
And as seldom as we did go out to eat, that would be a big thing. We would have a place called Ernie's Jr. And what's interesting about that, it went through generations of people. My mom and dad, as they were growing up in Lincoln Heights, would go there when they were dating. And they were still there when my wife and I got married in 1976. And we would go there. And when we had our first daughter, we would take her there. I don't know if they're still there to this day, but the generations of neighborhood eateries would follow the generations of the people who lived in the neighborhood.
And I think that was a big thing about that, you know, the restaurants, the family restaurants in the neighborhoods that were unique and everything. They would they'd be there for generations. One generation would work there, and then the kids would come up, and then they would work there, and the grandkids would come up, and so on and so forth. And I think to a great extent, a lot of that has been lost, but I think there's still exceptions to that rule. If there's still family restaurants that are still owned by the families, you know, all over the country. I'm sure of that because I know there's a couple of them here in our area.
Well, I suppose it's dying out like a lot of Americana that we experienced in the mid-20th century, Smitty. I think a family operation just can't survive anymore with the competition and the cost of things.
Right.
And, you know, people trying to get by just to get some eggs and milk for their families or get a tank of gas. It's just, you know, they have to keep up with the big corporate people. But it's most restaurants I know of nowadays are chain operated. Yep. They're corporate. And a vast difference in the service and, of course, a vast difference in the type of food. Mm-hmm. When you get a pizza at Casa Bianca, this was a pizza recipe handed down probably since the 1920s.
Sure, yeah.
And it wouldn't change one teaspoonful.
Yeah. Well, Mike, you know, going back to what we were talking about earlier, you know, when we got to be a little bit older and we were able to drive and maybe had a little job or something, all of a sudden the uniqueness of being able to get a hamburger or go to a fast food place or get something – that kind of went away, and all of a sudden it was accessible. We could go there pretty much any night of the week if we were out with our friends or even if we were out by ourselves, and you said, I feel like having a hamburger tonight. You could just drive in there and get something. So the uniqueness that it was when we were kids, that kind of went away, didn't it?
It certainly did, and even going out for a bucket of chicken.
Yeah.
It wasn't KFC back then, by the way, either. It was Colonel Sanders.
Yep.
Colonel Sanders. And Kentucky Fried Chicken, that was another Sunday dinner.
That was Sunday
staple,
ritual,
but
yeah.
It was takeout. It was pick-up and take-out. Seldom did you sit there and eat. And for one of the reasons being they didn't have dining rooms. It was more of a go-in order, get your bucket of chicken and your coleslaw and your mashed potatoes and head on home.
Yeah.
But now you can take your pick. It's not as enchanting. It's not as adventurous. It's not as unique as it was 50 years ago to pick up chicken or sushi.
Yeah, whatever it might be.
I don't remember sushi until about the 90s, I think, but that's just me.
Right. I remember, you know, Sunday afternoons sometimes when I was a kid, and sometimes my aunt would come visit us, and my dad would say, well, I'm going to go to Kentucky Fried Chicken and get a bucket of chicken, and he'd bring back the chicken with all the fixings. That was a unique treat also. That didn't happen all the time, but it happened a little bit more often than the hamburgers.
Yeah, and if you were the poor kid that got the chicken there at the bottom of the bucket that grease had been draining through, you were in for an experience. You were in for an interesting experience. I think that's probably why we take both take cholesterol medicine nowadays. Yeah. One of the reasons. But let's touch really very quickly on the buffet concept.
Oh, sure.
Of the 70s and 60s. Here in San Diego, they had a, was it King George's?
Sir George's.
Sir George's buffet.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Do you recall the buffet experience? Probably later on as you became a teenager and you were on your own, but was that something for about $3.75?
You could, yeah. You know, Mike, one of my first experiences, I had a very dear friend when I was growing up. He was a lot older than I was, but he was a gentleman who was a very good friend of mine. And I remember that there was a place here in San Diego that was sort of like a Swedish buffet.
Yeah.
And I remember him telling me, well, let's go to this Swedish buffet and you can eat all you want. And I'm going like, what?
What do they call them? Smorgasbord.
Smorgasbord. Yeah.
Smorgasbord. It's Olaf at the smorgasbord.
Yes, the smorgasbord.
So they had them down here.
They had them down here. Yeah. And to me, it was like, what? You mean? And then he said, yeah, you can, if you finish eating and you want more, you get up and you get more. And I'm going like, what? Really? I mean, it was like going to the moon. I mean, it was some crazy concept. And by God, we did go there, and he said, yeah, go ahead and help yourself. So you could eat as much as you want, but that concept came in. It's still here. It was kind of it kind of took a major hit during the pandemic, but it's still here. And that was really something, Mike, to be able to go to a place and you serve yourself, you serve whatever you want. Well, I don't want any of those green beans, but I want some of the potatoes, yeah. And I want some of the steak, but I don't want any of this or that. That was really neat to go there and kind of get as much as you want, wasn't it?
Well, there's a movie that always reminds me of those, Fargo.
Oh, uh-huh.
Where the chief of police, she's at the smorgasbord all the time. And it brings back some memories because I remember a lot of fried foods.
Yeah.
Fricassee, mm-hmm. Fried chicken, lots of potatoes, lots of French fries, lots of gravy.
Yeah.
But I recall, Sir George's, it was probably it wasn't even $5, Smitty.
It was very reasonable at that
time.
And then
they would have a whole section there as big as the regular section with desserts.
Yep.
And that's where I would lose my mind because they would have everything from cheesecake to ice cream to milkshakes, yep. And cake, everything in between.
Everything, yeah.
They
yeah.
tried to bring that back and what was it, Hometown? Hometown buffet?
Hometown buffet.
It just wasn't the same.
Then, yeah, it was different.
Maybe because we've changed. No, I don't think so.
I don't think so. I think it was a little bit different. Sir George's, I do remember that. And I'm wondering, maybe some of our listeners, if you had Sir George's in other parts of the country, you could let us know. But, that was an interesting concept. And you could go there and get as much as you want. And the desserts were plentiful. And it was crazy. It was really something.
And as we got older and got our driver's licenses and we're out on our own and we are limited budgets.
Yeah.
You'd go eat on the cheap.
That's it.
Pup and Taco. Were there Pup and Tacos in San Diego?
I don't believe there were, okay. But I certainly remember
seeing Taco Bells.
It. Oh, definitely Taco okay. Bells, yeah. Yeah.
But for a $5 bill, you could feed yourself and all the buddies with you in the car.
Sure.
And Pup and Taco was big in L.A., but yeah. They were tacos or hot dogs. You could take your pick. They were 19 cents a piece.
Wow. Can you imagine?
And if you really felt rich or you had a few extra coins in your pocket, you could get a cherry slush to go with it for 29 cents.
Wow.
So for under a dollar, you were set.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, that's something now.
Were, yeah, back in the day. That is crazy.
Where you have a situation nowadays, I don't know if you can find a taco anywhere for under $5 anymore.
Yeah, I mean, it's just kind of far and few between, you know. So, well, what great memories, Mike, talking about that. And certainly if you folks have any memories of early dining or when you were able to get out and go to a fast food place and what that was all about, why don't you drop us an email? We'd love to hear from you. Our email address is galaxymoonbeamnightside@gmail.com. galaxymoonbeamnightside@gmail.com. Our website is galaxymoonbeamnightsite.com. Our good buddy George Halilakos always has a great post there each and every month, so we invite you to join us there. Don't forget our Galaxy page on Facebook, the Galaxy Moonbeam Nightsite page on Facebook, and join us there for to become our friend and then you'll be updated every time we post a new show and we have something else going on. Don't forget, all of our library of well over 250 programs is now available for your listening pleasure at iTunes and on Google Podcast. And on Mixcloud, we are no longer posting our newer shows to Mixcloud. However, our older shows are there for your listening pleasure. So if you missed any of our earlier shows, you can catch them there. And don't forget, all you listeners who are out in East Texas, KFRO, AM 1370, and you can hear us there every Sunday night beginning at 9 p.m. Central Time. So that is the show for this time around. We thank you so much for joining us. Until next time, I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And thank you for joining us on Galaxy Moonbeam Nightsight on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
This is the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.